everyone. This is Bill DeLuca here at Theater 100, our backstage class here on television, film, and theater. And this is our final broadcast. 13 weeks now, we have gone through almost everything from acting to directing to design to actual playwriting, looking at television and film. So it's been a long process, and that's one thing we want to do today is kind of bring it back in something of a review. But the main topic today that we'll be looking at is lights and sound. You really can't have a performance that everyone's going to see unless you have some good lighting, and that is often not counted on as being such a significant part, but it truly is. I can tell you from my own students' observations here on our discussion board, like Michael Williams just said, I never knew how many different lighting aspects there were. There's different light for everything. Overlights, footlights, shadow lights, spotlights, fading, washout. It's amazing to think that a production would fail depending on if the correct lights are used or not. So thank you, Michael, for forwarding that discussion board posting. And that's what we really want to focus on, is the importance of lights as well as sound today. So if you can join us like Mikhail has done on the discussion board, feel free to offer your comments or respond to any of our focus questions that we'll offer you today. This is live and online, so feel free to either call us on that toll-free number right there, 1-800-339-1193, or go online and follow Mikhail's lead and type us something that is an observation of something you may know about in terms of lighting or costume or sound, or you may respond to something that we talk about. We do want to talk a little bit about contemporary theater as well. So, yeah, it's an interactive medium. We've been saying that quite a lot, and feel free to connect with us. In fact, one thing that might help you to connect is a focus question. So let's look today at the question, what are some objectives for a lighting designer in a play? It's worthwhile thinking, what do you think he or she may need to do? What is their task to provide lighting for a show? It's obviously to light the stage, but there's a lot more to it than just providing general illumination. So feel free to respond to that. What are some objectives for a lighting designer in a play? And I'd love to hear from you on the phone there, 1-800-339-1193, or if you'd like to go online, feel free to contact us on our website. And if you post a question, I will be able to read it here on the monitors for you, and we'll be able to have something of a discussion. Sorry, I'm going to my assignment page here. Oh, there it is, dhtv.csudh.edu. So feel free to use the online spot. So looking at our assignment page, we're all the way down to the bottom here. May 3rd, lights and sound. And I just want to point out to our students that it's all coming to a fast finish here. As we say in theater, you have to end big. So we've got a lot of assignments for you this week. We're reading chapter 12 on lights and sound. And we're also taking a quiz. This is your final quiz, this is your ninth quiz, and Mikhail has just contributed to the 13th discussion board. So you all finish at the end of this week. But then when you turn the corner and read your assignment page, you'll see that next week is the final exam. So starting on May 9th, which is Monday, from 9 o'clock in the morning, all the way through till Friday. So I'd have to tell you that that's Friday the 13th, all the way till midnight. Maybe you should try to do your paper before that Friday so there's not any bad luck in taking it. That's all the time that you have to do this. It's a pretty short exam, but it is timed, so you will need to kind of know ahead of time how you're going to answer. And again, as you'll see on the website here on the assignment page, it's chapters 4, 7, 8, 10, 11, 12, 13, 15, and they are the second half of the course. So it's not a comprehensive exam. It's just the second half. Also, your items on film techniques are included in this exam as well. So please look over your assignment page. That'll help you there and contribute to an evaluation of the course. There's a discussion board that I'd love to hear from you what we thought was working and what could be improved for Theater 100. Okay, to finish off the long process that I began in our first broadcast, which is to look at the history of theater, we're all the way up to contemporary theater. So let's talk a little bit about some of the more recent forms that have evolved in the world using theater. We have just closed a show that was perhaps one of the latest forms of doing theater, community-based theater, where you actually interview people in the community and make a play out of it. The Brenda Project closed on Sunday after five performances, and it did very well, especially considering that so many people are affected by breast cancer, so the topic was very relevant. And the idea of taking stories from survivors and putting them into the play was quite well realized by our two playwrights, Naomi Buckley and Susan Thrasher. So there's a lot of people to thank for this, as well as all the many people who contributed to the production, as well as to the original idea. So it was truly a community-based play. And although, obviously, theater has been done with communities since the very beginning, this phrase, community-based, is different than just community theater. It means that you have taken the time to listen to members of the community in telling stories and making the play from their stories. That is, has come to be known as perhaps the highest form of audience development, because what better way to get the audience to come and see the show but to ask them for the story that you're going to stage. So to some extent, it is a networking form of theater that connects to the audience even before the play is written. So it is perhaps the latest great development, at least in American theater, and I'm proud that we are part of it here at Dominguez Hills. Okay, so, but really, I think I left you guys off last time with theater of the 60s, which will change the way theater is looked at. The reaction against realism was very strong in the beginning of the 20th century, and it comes back in a major way in the 1960s, where we get a lot of highly abstract works, and also a new kind of incentive for theater, the idea of using theater to create a political statement. And if you consider the 1960s, there was a lot to react against. Obviously, the Vietnam War became a focus point for many of these theater companies. The whole civil rights movement was a unique way to kind of stage some of the injustice that African Americans were feeling. And along with that comes what happened with Luis Valdez and the Chicano theater movement in California, which spread throughout the country, as well as rights for women, gays, and lesbians. Many theater groups were initiated in the 60s and 70s. Feminist theater really took off in the 70s. But let's look at some of the groups that made this possible. And one of the unique groups is the Living Theater. The Living Theater was actually a very talented group of professionals. This is actually an image from The Magnanimous Cuckold, which, not a mistake, because Meyerhold was a Russian artist who created sets that did not look in any way realistic. And it's a strange connection, but the Living Theater wanted to realize a lot of what many of the European and Russian artists were saying, that theater should be more of a ritual act and not just something where an audience sits passively and just watches the show and then goes home feeling that everything's okay. Meyerhold in The Magnanimous Cuckold, as well as the Living Theater in their play Six Public Acts, wanted to change the way people thought and actually change society as a result of their seeing a piece of theater. And strangely enough, there was a man, Antonin Artaud, who wrote about this in the 1920s and 30s. And everybody thought he was a nut, the idea of trying to recreate the ritual aspect of theater, put audiences into situations where they would leave the theater and want to change the world for the better. They thought he was a nut in the 1920s, but in the 1960s, many of these great artists, like the Living Theater, I guess we don't have an image on the Living Theater, but they were a talented group of performers, but often their shows featured nudity and drugs. They were very much of the day in the 1960s, but it was an attempt to make a political statement either about Vietnam or other issues that were strong in their mind. We have a little clip of Marat Saad, which is actually another, there's an image from it. This was a play that was also a unique piece of work. It was written by Peter Weiss in 1961, but it was beautifully staged by Peter Brook. Peter Brook read all of the work of Antonin Artaud, was very influenced by artists like Meyerhold and Brecht, and very much felt that theater should address our social problems. Now, Marat Sade, very unique play in that it features Jean-Paul Marat, who was a famous motivator of the French Revolution, and the Marquis de Sade, who is famous for S&M, if you will. That's where the word comes from. And these two characters appear in this play, but you'll notice that there is a lot of rallying going on because the play was really meant to speak out against some of the problems of the day. Obviously, Vietnam was one. And the play, to some extent, is encouraging people to go out and revolt against the government. So that's, in a way, part of what the 60s was all about. So here you'll see it in a beautifully directed production by Peter Brook called Marat Sade.
Instruments for mental and physical hygiene. Quite on the contrary, they set the scene. In Monsieur de Sade's play, he has tried to show how Jean-Paul Marat died, and how he waited in his bath before Charlotte Corday came knocking at his door.
Distinguished visitors, let us go back to the France of 15 years ago. Recall the greatest shock of modern times, those golden victories. Scarlet crimes. The force which shattered every institution. That global earthquake, the French Revolution. None of us knew a revolutionary more passionate than Marat. But was he the people's friend or freedom's enemy? A writer of books with hope on every page, or the most vicious butcher of his age? Marat the good or bad? The choice is hard. Let us hear Marat debating with de Sade, two champions wrestling with each other's views. How do we judge the winner? You must choose. Here is Marat, back from the dead. He wears a bandage around his head. His flesh burns. It is yellow as cheese, because disfigured by a skin disease. And only water, cooling every limb, prevents his fever from consuming him. To act this weighty role, we chose a lucky paranoid, one of those who've made unprecedented strides since we introduced them to hydrotherapy. This one was with him to the very end. Simon Evra, his dogged lady friend. Here is Charlotte Corday, waiting for her entry. A country girl, her family landed gentry. Unfortunately, the girl who plays the role here has sleeping sickness, also melancholia. Our hope must be for this afflicted soul that she does not forget her role. Her friend is Monsieur Duperey. You'll note his upper-class toupee. This actor's good, though subject to attacks. One of our brightest sexual maniacs. Jailed for taking a radical view of anything you can name. The former priest, Jacques Roux, ally of Marat's revolution. But unfortunately, the censors cut most of his rabble-rousing theme. Our moral guardians found it too extreme. And now, our vocalists, Cuckoo-Cuckoo! Pop-pop! Cuckoo! And on the streets, no longer, Rossignol. Now meet this gentleman from high society, who under the lurid star of notoriety came to live with us just 5 years ago. It's to his genius that we owe this show, the former Marquis Monsieur de Sade, whose books were banned, his essays barred, while he's been persecuted and reviled, thrown into jail and for some years exiled. The introduction's over. Now the play of Jean-Paul Marat can get underway. Tonight, the date is the 13th of July, 1808. And on this night, our cast intend showing how 15 years ago, night without end fell on this man, this invalid. And you are going to see him plead and see this woman, after careful thought, take up the dagger and cut him short.
Homage to Marat!
Very odd way of doing a play. I don't know if you caught the storyline there, but this is an insane asylum, and the inmates are asked to put on the play. So they're playing the roles of these characters, and that explains the bars that separate the audience from the performers. So it's meant to be something of an in-house performance, but obviously we want our long live the revolution. It became something of a rallying cry in the 60s for revolution itself. So quite a popular show. It was internationally done, and it was done very well by the actors of the Royal Shakespeare Company. So these were talented performers. So yeah, Marat Sade, very much a reflection of the 60s. Another good reflection of the 60s is something close to home here, the San Francisco Mime Troupe, still going strong after, I think, like 45 years. They began in the late 50s, and throughout the 60s and 70s, they were quite popular for their satirical approach to contemporary issues. So they might do a play on Vietnam or on Nixon or on abortion. They picked the issues first and then they made a play out of it that would satirize and kind of make fun of some contemporary political figures. Strange thing about the Mime Troupe, though, is they were all very, very well-trained performers. They studied circus techniques. They studied commedia dell'arte techniques. They were great gymnasts. I mean, they were in great shape, fabulous vocal work, good singers. So a very talented, entertaining group, but with a very strong political message. And as I said earlier, they're alive and well, still going in San Francisco, usually performing outside in parks, making tours of college campuses. So, yeah, the San Francisco Mime Troupe, if they ever come to town, go and see them. Another interesting troupe that was very similar, but on the East Coast, well, I shouldn't say East Coast, but in Vermont, was the Bread and Puppet Theater. Now, this was, they were created in 1961, and they used puppets of various sizes, some that were 2 and 3 stories tall. Literally, you would have people on stilts, and they would do a performance in the Village in New York, and you'd see them coming down the street. I mean, it was amazing. But their themes were always some statement against oppression. I mean, a lot of the stories were drawn from the Bible. It was very topical ideas that ran their playwrights. But it was mainly to kind of denounce the evils of materialism and any kind of deception that the government was pulling over. So again, another a group that reacted against some things that were going wrong in the 60s. And also we have, from the 60s, the development of a postmodernist style. And when we say that, we're really talking about a kind of blur between art and reality here. Postmodernism is probably best defined in examples like The French Lieutenant's Woman, which is a novel where the narrator is a modern person, but then they enter the actual story, which takes place centuries, well, in Victorian times, another century away, and they end up even confessing in the novel that they don't know how it's going to end. So it kind of blurs our traditional understanding. Very eclectic, very much mixing, especially in theater, the various styles. So you might take a highly realistic play like Our Town, which when was done by the Performance Garage in the 1980s, they did it in a style that was almost melodramatic. And so the mix of styles is another aspect to postmodernism, and we still have that very strongly today. Perhaps one of the most famous postmodernists was Robert Wilson. Wilson was something of a performance artist. I mean, he did do theater. He did theater on a grand scale, but it was done more as a mix of dance and music and theater. Not that we don't have music, all those elements in a piece of musical theater, but a lot of his work was highly visual and highly repetitious. He wanted to get back to those same ideas that Artaud was talking about in terms of ritual and repetition. So he'd have a dancer like Lucinda Childs, and she would probably do a motion that was the same motion constantly for almost 15 minutes. In many of his performances, he'd have people who would be spinning, literally like spinning around and continually spinning for the entire duration of the show. So the idea of repeating was very much at the source of Wilson's ideas. But the way he used sculpture and dance and music, a lot of wonderful work by Philip Glass was very central to his massive productions. Einstein on the Beach was one of his shows, for instance, that took 8 hours to perform, and it was done at an opera. There's a good image of Einstein there. But most of his works were very much like in slow motion, very meditative for the audience. But similar to no drama, as we talked about in the history of theater, it in a way becomes mesmerizing for an audience. Another great artist of the 60s was Richard Foreman, who created a theater called the Ontological Hysterical Theater, and very mysterious performances that were very hard to understand. This is an image from Rhoda in Potato Land. And Foreman would actually have pieces of string that went across the stage for no reason other than to kind of just compose the pictures. And a lot of his works were kind of like moving artworks. And characters would stay out there, and they might not say anything, or they might not ever shut up. They might just continually be talking. He himself would often be on a microphone, just talking generally about art throughout the whole process. So it was very unstructured, very much an attempt to deconstruct the process of thought in theatrical art. He was almost reacting against any form of logic in putting together a play. So it was kind of like watching an art object come alive and dancing in front of our eyes. But very, very unique form of theater. Similar to the Mabu Minds, another wonderfully artistic group that had a variety of talented performers and artists like Lee Brewer and Joanne Acolytis. And they were very influenced by Bunraku, the Japanese form of theater, and did a number of their performances using small puppets. They did one performance once that was just feet. They had a curtain that was down very low, and you just were amazed how interesting feet could be. And the feet actually had lines and said things. But a lot of their animations, what they called their plays, the Bee Beaver animation, the Gospel at Colonus, which was a takeoff of the great Oresteia, but was done to African-American music, were just highly artistic and almost surprising imagery. So the Mabu Minds, another great, great group. Spalding Gray helped to initiate a whole form of theater that is now very much accepted, and that's monologuing. Gray would have a whole performance that might last 2 hours that was just simply him up there talking. Sometimes he'd be sitting in a seat, very untheatrical, but his his vivid descriptions of something that may be a segment of his life, or swimming to Cambodia was one of his works that made him very famous. But all of his monologue performances were very unique. And now we have many great artists. Eric Bogosian was followed on, and it's become almost a unique form of having a one man or one woman show now. And sometimes it's combined with a lot of performance art. So a whole new form kind of came out of Spalding Gray's work. A lot of it tends to be autobiographical, just for him, not only for him, but for many of the artists who followed him. Here's a good example of the kind of work that that came out of the 60s. Anna Deavere Smith was first a professor of speech, and she was studying how people spoke. She would tape people, but she wanted to recreate how they spoke without any interest in performing them as characters. But then later on, some of her work became so interesting that she started turning it into theater. And she was very much listening to problems that were happening in the world. So when there was a riot between blacks and Jewish people in the Crown Heights section of Brooklyn, she did a show on that called Fires in the Mirror. In fact, later she came to Los Angeles for the Rodney King riots and did a piece on the riots here. But this is a very unique form of theater, you'll have to agree. Now it's film, you're watching a film version, but try to imagine, if you will, Anna Deavere Smith doing these characters. Fires in the Mirror featured her doing about 35 different characters, all herself. But she would transform in an amazing way to these different characters. So here's a little clip from Fires in the Mirror. I knew I wouldn't. I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't. So good. So good. I got you. Oh, I feel nice.
James Brown raised me. I never had a father. My father left when I was 10. James Brown took me to the beauty parlor one day and made my hair like his and made me promise to wear it like that to the day I die. I always wanted a father, and he filled a void for me. And I can't think of anybody who demonstrated such strength that he reached such heights, and then he fell so low, and then he had to come back up. I can't think of anybody in life who deserved that tribute. That he wanted a kid, somebody to look like him and be just like his son. I just came back from spending a weekend with him now. I think James Brown deserved that tribute. And just like he was a father, I never had. His kids never even came to visit him when he was in jail. So I was the son he never had. And if I had to choose between arguing with people by my hairstyle or giving James Brown that one tribute he asked, I'd rather give him that tribute. And I really don't give a damn who don't understand it. But, oh, no, I know. I know. I know. Not you. Not you. But the press, everybody, do that thing on it. It's a personal family thing between me and James Brown. Just like in some communities, people had their cultural thing of who they want to look like. Ain't nothing the matter with me and James doing that. It's us. In the 50s, it was a slick. It was acting like white folks. But today, ain't nobody out here wearing their hair like that no more. Me and James are the ones doing that. So it's certainly not a reaction to whites. It's me and James's thing.
Well, different Hasidic communities have different customs about hair. And Lubavitch, the custom is, I think, that it has to be 2 inches. And some Hasidic groups have the custom of shaving the head, but that's not a Lubavitch custom. And the reason is that when you go to the mikveh bath, maybe you know, you have to be completely submerged in water, and the hair has a tendency to float. So it's much easier if the hair is shorter. And I got married when I was a little older, and I really wanted to be married, and I really wanted to, in some ways, I was eager to cover my head. Now, if I'd grown up in a Lubavitch household and then had to cut it, I don't know what that would be like. I really don't. But, you know, now that I'm wearing the wig, you see, with my hair, I could keep it very simple, or I could change it all the time. I mean, with a wig, you'd have to have 5 wigs to do that. And I just feel like the wig is fake, you know, and I like to be as much myself as I possibly can, and I just feel like I'm fooling the world. When I used to work in the city, I'd wear a different wig, and people would say to me, gee, I like your new haircut. And I'd have to say, it's not mine. And it was very hard. It was very difficult to say it, and I've gone through a lot with wearing the wig and not wearing the wig. It's been a big issue for me.
I mean, this is a unique form of theater when you are choosing, first of all, real people, Reverend Al Sharpton as a Lubavitch woman, but these are all based around the Crown Heights battle that actually happened there. It was a riot scene back in the 90s. And so out of this event, she is drawing information from these characters, real people, but then performing them. So to some extent, it may seem naturalistic, but it is a unique way of doing theater. And again, it very much fits into something of a 60s mindset of wanting to go against the grain of just traditional theatrical performance. So performance artists begin to explore much different venues in terms of using their arts. So Anna Deavere Smith is certainly one of them. And in a similar way, it was a unique work that Intosaki Shangay created in the late 70s when she wrote For Colored Girls Who Have Considered Suicide When the Rainbow Is Enough. Now, many of you may have seen the movie that Tyler Perry just came out with, but the original play is really meant for the stage, and it has, I think, a lot more impact on an audience when you see it live. And the idea of having a kind of archetypal image of these 7 women that is not naturalistic. They're all dressed in kind of tights, different colored tights with scarves or necklace or whatever pieces or accessories are there. But it's basically almost like you're looking at a dancer rather than a character in a play from a certain area. The movie was quite realistic, and that was one thing that Tyler Perry did that was very different from the original play. But it was a very passionate look at the pain of African-American women who were triply oppressed by race, gender, and class as well in the late 70s. So it became something of a rallying cry, but it was also done with great poetry and great performance. So it was not realistic in any sense of the word. These performances were done straight out to an audience. It wasn't, sometimes they were interacted. But again, breaking that fourth wall and going into a whole new kind of venue in terms of the artistry. And in fact, Colored Girls was quite inspiring for many other artists who have continued today. Contemporary theater is filled with writers, actors, designers who want to kind of break the mold. I don't know if any of you saw the Brenda project that we did, but it was very much an abstract world. There was a large tree on stage. You may have remembered Jeff Eisenman coming in and showing us the model. A kind of otherworldly place, even though the play was about breast cancer and based on particular people's lives, it seems that contemporary theater has moved away from just portraying live people on stage and rather creating more their archetype, more their character and what they represent in society. So that's a unique part of contemporary theater, and it goes back to a lot of plays like Colored Girls and many of the other groups in the 60s who kind of broke us away from the mold that Tennessee Williams and Eugene O'Neill and Arthur Miller perhaps created. So it's a much freer environment, and one wonderful part about contemporary theater is just how much diversity there is whether it's Native American. We now have some unique playwrights who are writing about the Native American experience, and Hispanic American plays. We have so many different festivals all over the country now. It's not just like in New York that celebrate Latino writers. South Coast Rep had the Hispanic Plays program for many years, and out of that has come the Octavio Solises and the Sherry Moragas and the Jose Cruz Gonzalez's. So we have quite a vibrant scene in terms of Hispanic American, as well as women playwrights, as well as Asian American. The Asian American community has just exploded in terms of its wonderful offerings, from M. Butterfly, David Henry Hwang, to Philip Cotanda, to Diana Song. It's amazing how many different expressions there are in so many, it's from so many different voices. So yes, contemporary theater is a rainbow, if you will, as Entosaki Shange referred to in her title. Well, let's talk a little bit about lighting designers before we take a break. In fact, that's one of the questions that we have for today, is what do you think is the objective behind what a lighting designer does? So some of our students, I can see, are already talking about it on the website. But feel free to respond yourself if you'd like to either call us or log in to our website. We'd love to hear from you. But there's certainly nothing more necessary, obviously, for an inside theater than lighting to help us see the performers and, you know, gain a feeling for the world that we're visiting. And sound does play a major part in locating us as well. And sometimes we're not really aware of sound. It influences us as it does in film. You're not kind of conscious that it's there, but it's somehow affecting you. So, let's look at both of these wonderful forms that are so influential on our experience. Obviously, the history of stage lighting is unique because it was all outside until the Renaissance, when rich nobles began to invite people into their halls to see performances that were prepared, and these immediately became very sophisticated works. But you needed to have candles, candelabra perhaps, maybe a series of candles, lowered down near the performers to be able to see them. Then they created reflectors around the candles that at least pushed the light in a certain direction. This is an early dimming device. When you wanted the lights to go down, you could lower these two tubes over the candle so that it would dim the light to a certain extent. But it wasn't until electricity and gaslight came in the 19th century that we were seeing performers with any great work. This is a Sabatini dimming device, actually, and it was used quite extensively. But you can imagine how ineffective it would be. It wouldn't hold off all the light. So, yeah, it's not until 1803 when we first get the first gas-lit theaters. And then later, once we get to the 1880s, we're going to get electricity, which is a much safer form. Many theaters burned down because of gas lighting. Realized that gas involved miles and miles of pipe that had to be run through a theater to be able to create this open flame that would provide a reflected light onto the stage. And obviously, we have a terrible history of many who have lost their lives in the 19th century until the incandescent lamp saved lives, as well as provided a form of dimming, because you could actually make the light grow more intense or dim it without Sabatini's device from the Renaissance. And by the time we get to the 20th century, we get forms of creating light, like the Stanley McCandless system, which featured having a light around 45 degrees above a performer and then 45 degrees on the other side of their face, and using different colors, one which would be cool and one which would be warm, and it would give more definition to the face. And in addition to that, lighting from above, as well as side lighting and back lighting, provides a much more molded form for the actor on stage, as well as scenery, too. But by the early 20th century, that was in place, as well as dimming devices so that you could control light and and focus it on certain areas and isolate light as well. But the long history of theater was really messy because it was all outside. But let's look at some of the objectives that a lighting designer has to consider. Obviously, to provide visibility is a major one, so I'm sure some of our students will focus on that. But interesting dilemma that happens between that lighting designer and the director, because visibility is a basic function, but your designer wants to create a certain mood. So there's a contrast between providing visibility and also creating a sense of mood. If the color or the mood is so strong that the audiences can't see the actor, it's going to be a problem. In fact, the audience won't hear the actors that well if they can't see them. It's a strange connection there. And directors, if it's a comedy, are always asking for much, much brighter light. That helps an audience to learn that they can laugh here. Whereas if it's dark and mysterious, you're a little reticent to laugh. But that's an interesting debate between mood and visibility. Well, let's see what some of our students are saying, because our focus question is, what are some of the objectives that a lighting designer would have? And I see Priscilla is going to start us off. Thank you, Priscilla. It's good to hear from you guys on the last performance, as if this is a stage show. It's not the last broadcast. Sorry about that. But Priscilla's saying, I think a lighting designer's ultimate goal is to get the audience to focus on what he or she wants them to focus on. The lighting is there to guide their eyes. It's a good way of putting it, Priscilla. It's not like in a film where you can actually say, okay, we've had the establishing shot. Now let's get a close-up of Priscilla. Let's bring that zoom right in here, and they can just see her in the whole frame. On a big stage especially, you have to draw the audience's attention to what's important, and sometimes lighting is the only choice to do that. Don't know if you saw the Brenda Project, but there was a moment there where a character who has been struggling with her own denial about her breast cancer, she wears scarves to cover her baldness. We had a shaft of light, a very intense shaft of light, and Mama, who has been kind of like this healing figure for the women, brings Kara into the light, and it's the light itself that provides something of a lesson for Kara, that she has to let it go, and she actually takes off her scarf, and you see she's bald. We used a bald cap. The actor wasn't actually shaven, but the light itself provided a kind of transformation in the scene. So obviously, Priscilla, you couldn't see anything but that character under that intense light at that moment. But it was meant to be something much more than just letting them see the character. The light was actually motivating a kind of transformation for the character. And I see we have Emily here responding to our question about the objectives of a lighting designer. Emily's saying, the lighting designers want to be sure that they highlight one character during the appropriate times and show all the characters on stage. That's a good point too, Emily. There's a balance between what has to have the main focus, but you don't want to lose the surround as well. So that's very difficult to create a sense that there's an ensemble, a world of the play, and also a point of focus in the play. You don't want to just have Hamlet standing in one shaft of light and it's dark everywhere else. I mean, you could use that at a moment. But it's kind of nice to see that there's a little light up there on Claudius, who is the person who killed his father. Maybe another one on one side of the stage that shows his mother. Maybe there's a light on Ophelia. But that Hamlet has the main focus, but you sense the world around him. So, yeah, it's a balancing act for a good lighting designer. And here's Bree, who's saying that lighting can set the mood of a scene, and it can help create a scene. Most importantly, it lights up the characters so that the audience can see them well. So, good. I'm glad Bree agrees with me. Visibility is very important, and the audience will be very frustrated if they can't see them. Another thing I want to talk about a little bit, too, is that a lighting designer's objective needs to be concerned with depth. Light has a great compositional value to not only provide focus, but to provide a sense of depth. Adolf Appia was a great theorist in the 1920s, 1930s, and he felt that the actor is three-dimensional. The actor is not like scenery that's painted on a two-dimensional flat. He felt that if you've got a three-dimensional actor, then your lighting has to exploit that. So he felt that there should be different sources of light so that when you see an actor's face, if you put a single spotlight just in front, you know, facing an actor, and you sat in the audience and watched, it's almost like it'd be like a painted picture. It would wash out the features of the face. The face would almost go flat. So by having different angles, the face becomes more shadowed, and there's depth in the face. Now, I'm not just the face, we're talking about the whole set to create a sense of depth, as in a photograph when you want depth of field. So lighting also provides that, which engages an audience. It makes it a much more interesting stage picture. So that's another aspect, too, to help your director provide a sense of depth to the story. And in addition to that, let's not forget that lighting can help provide a sense of time. It may be a morning scene with long shadows that are lit from a certain corner of the stage, may even be from off in the wings, or it may give us a sense of where we are. Courtroom lighting is a lot different than the lighting in a bedroom, let's say. So, and sometimes you'll be in a play where the lighting seems strange for where you are. You're watching a game that's like a soccer game, a couple people playing in a soccer game, and it has a very kind of mysterious, otherworldly feeling. It doesn't look like they're on a soccer field. So sometimes lighting can give us a sense of where and when this is taking place. I see Ramzan has a comment about our focus question as well. Thank you, Ramzan. The lighting designer's key tasks, as I see it, is to add warmth to the script and to provide audiences focus to specific actors when and as necessary. I like the idea there that you're providing warmth to the script. And that is, for the Brenda Project, for instance, it would have been very strange to have these women who are telling their stories about their own treatment in breast cancer to be in bluish light. Not that we didn't have blue. Tom Marinello did use blues in his compositions. But the more predominant feeling was a warm color. And it made it feel that even though these women are suffering, they're going to be better because they're in a supportive environment. And you don't say that in your head as you're watching and say, oh, look at the warm lights on them. You just feel that there's warmth there. So light has a very kind of mysterious way of working on us without us having to be objectively aware of it. Good, Ramzan. Good comment. And Cassie is also responding to our question. I think an objective for a lighting designer would be not to have the audience notice the lighting. Oh, I like that, Cassie. It shouldn't distract the audience from what's happening. That's a very good point. If kind of like scenery too, or costumes, if the moment of what's happening in the play becomes more about that hat she's wearing or that outrageous ramp that he's walking up, or as Cassie's saying, if the lighting draws so much focus that we're just saying, oh, isn't this fabulous? Look, how did they do that? Great effect. And you miss what's happening, something's wrong. Something's wrong. I like that, Cassie, that you're saying the design work should support the story that we're seeing. And that is very difficult sometimes to gauge how far we can go with a certain effect. The one I was talking to you about in the Brenda Project, for instance, was a case in point. I didn't want the audience to be so aware of the light that that's all they watched, and they didn't hear Kara going through this monologue of her own torment. That had to be primary, but the light had to have some influence on her. So it was hotter, as we say, than most lights on stage, but not so much that it just made you forget about what the character was doing. So very good point, Cassie. I like that. I just want to point out, too, that there are two kinds of lights on stage. There are source-motivated lights. For instance, when you have a sunrise, you want the light to be coming from one side because you feel the sun is off stage over there and the light is coming from that. Or if someone comes into a room and actually turns on a lamp, you don't want the lights on the other side of the room to go on. It has to happen kind of right around here. So the source is motivating the lights to happen. And sometimes, you know, when you're creating naturalistic effects, that can be quite complicated. There's never, for instance, in a stage set, a switch on the wall that actually controls the light. You know that the actor is just doing a fake switch there, and it's the control people in the booth who are determining that light function. So it's not that easy to make it believable. But also there are sources that are not motivated. Very presentational lighting is, for instance, a follow spot. I don't know if you've ever been to a musical, for instance, where someone's singing a great solo, and all of a sudden a light comes on, and as the actor walks around, the light follows them. Follow spot. That's theatrical. That's not something you would see in, you know, your everyday reality. So, and many lighting effects are done to create a sense of theater, and especially in a musical comedy, when we want to kind of bump up the theatrical feeling of a story, especially during a song. So, yeah, there's those two kinds there. All right, I see we have Vanessa making a comment about our focus question. It's great to have all you guys responding to our final questions here. I believe that the light designer's major role is to provide a sense of characteristics, feelings, and attitudes a character feels on stage, showing feelings with colors and lights to create a mood. That's very good, Vanessa, spoken as a true actor, actress, because a good lighting designer does read for what is happening to the characters at the moment. You can't just say, oh, I have a great effect in mind for this scene, if you don't realize what the storyline is telling us that the experience is. Because after all, what the actors are feeling, what the character supposedly is feeling in their story, the audience, you want the audience to feel that. You want that to convey to them. So it has to be consistent. So I appreciate, Vanessa, what you just said about that. A couple more things in terms of lighting before we take our break. The properties of stage lighting. Realize that it's a question of intensity, a question of color, of the direction that the light is coming in, and movement. You know, brightness is always discussed during the tech of a show, and that's a lot of what the job is. How high is that level? Let's bring it down a little bit. So intensity, very, very important. Color, major influential aspect, as Vanessa was just mentioning to us. I mentioned the Stanley McCandless system of color mixing, how that can create a sense of believability and depth as well. But color, especially when you're in different costumes. There's a wonderful image in our chapter. I don't know if you've enjoyed this chapter, but I thought some of the imagery was quite well. There's a picture on, if you're using the 12th edition, page 288 or 286, where you have an example of a set that is all muted, similar to our Brenda project, where everything was off-white. The tree was off-white, the sand. This is a great example. I don't know how close you can get to this, but everything is off-white except for the characters who are in colors. And then down below, underneath it, you have the opposite case where you have the lighting is really kind of magenta all across the set, but in the very center, you have a character who's dressed in off-white and lit very nicely to reflect her kind of sense of purity within this wonderfully colored environment. So you see the contrast between these two images of the same stage set. So that is a perfect example of the impact that color can have on costumes. So your lighting designer has to talk to your costumer and your set designer to make sure we don't have any problems or work out beautiful examples like that. Also, movement. Great designers know how to make light move. When you do a fade off of one scene and bring up the lights to another scene, you're establishing a sense of rhythm almost for the play. So, and there are times where you bring lights up on a scene And as the scene gets more and more intense and maybe gets focused on two of the characters who are left in the scene, designers will sometimes take away the surrounding light and really focus the scene on those two characters. So the light actually has a sense of movement to it. It leads you along. That's really a sophisticated use of lighting. And as you know now, we have light instruments that actually move. This is a lot of what has happened from our discos and our dance world has come into the theater. And we actually have instruments now, very unique instruments that move as well. Finally, some of the other important things is to realize that focus is, for a stage instrument, a way of focusing the instrument on a certain area. There's actually a way of focusing the instrument so that for an ellipsoidal reflector, you get a very tight beam on the stage floor, whereas for a Fresnel instrument, you get a very soft beam. So focus is something that designers are concerned with. A light plot is a very complicated ground plan, but in addition to what's on the set, it has the battens, the pipes. And along those pipes, the lighting designer actually has in a scale drawing the actual instruments, every instrument, and what color they are, what amperage they are. So all the information about that instrument is there on that light plot. Very, very complicated, and that's the main tool that a lighting designer works with. Realize, too, that you go through cues. You might find in a college production like we just did 45 different cues. If it's a musical, it probably goes up to 200. In a Broadway play, you might have 300 cues, okay? A cue is just anytime something happens. So when that light fades and another light comes up, that's a cue. A blackout or lights up on a scene, that's another cue. So these are all worked out with the stage manager as to what the actual line is that determines that lighting designer's cue to a new image. A dimmer is traditionally what you plug all of these instruments into so that you can pull up one. In the past, it was a lever. Now it's a button on the computer that brings up maybe five instruments together, ganged together. So you get a lot of control. Backlighting, I've mentioned too, provides a lot of modeling for whatever the image is, an actor. Just as downlighting creates kind of a macabre effect when you have a light that's coming straight down over you, but it does also help to shape the actor. And we mentioned crossfades. That's tradition of taking some lights out and bringing more lights on to draw your attention to another section of the stage, let's say, where this next scene is going to happen. And then obviously a blackout, when maybe on a three count the lights come down slowly to bring us to a blackout so that the audience can now applause before we bring up the curtain call, music and lights. So, yeah, some basics there. I think maybe what we should do is take our break here, and I want to talk a little bit about sound when we come back, but also I hope you'll talk a little bit with me about summarizing this course, and I'd like to hear a little bit of evaluation. So we'll talk when we come back about what you may have learned about in terms of the differences between television, film, and theater, and I would love to hear how you think we could even improve the class. So join us in the second half for sound and an evaluation of the class in Theater 100.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Ladies and gentlemen, and particularly Senator Ted Lieu and your beautiful wife Betty and your family, welcome to the 55th Assembly District, now a part of, as you well know, the 28th Senate District, which you now represent. Ladies and gentlemen, it's always great to have such pomp and circumstance to remind all of us of the role of government and the important work that we do.
I'd like to ask the Honorable Ted Lieu to come on stage, and with the Chairman of the Board of Equalization, Jerome Horton, a former California State Assembly member, an Inglewood City Council member, and as you heard, a graduate of this fine institution, to administer the oath of office.
Aye. State your name.
Ted Lieu.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
With Betty's permission. Without any mental reservations,
without any mental reservations,
or purpose of evasion,
or purpose of evasion,
and that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties,
and that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties,
upon which I am about to enter,
upon which I am about to enter,
by the power vested in me, I hereby announce and present to all of you the Senator Ted Lieu.
Hi, my name is Ishmael Lewis Summers. I am a transfer student from Humboldt State University to Dominguez Hills. I am a DMA major at Dominguez Hills, and why I chose the school was because of their digital media art program. And what I like about this school is that it is cool and it is very diverse.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, Bill DeLuca back at Theater 100. We're going to look a little bit at the functions of a sound designer for the second half, as well as conclude our final broadcast here in our week 13 of Theater 100. So let me ask a different question here. Do you think that it's a good idea to amplify a non-musical serious play? Should performers' voices be amplified by sound technology in a non-musical play? We're used to seeing them in musicals, so But if you were looking at a serious play, would you feel that there should be that they should be amplified, they should be wearing microphones, even if they're just simply saying lines, not singing songs? So I'll be curious to get your response to that too. But obviously the functions of a sound designer are to reproduce sound for sound effects. And sound effects, a very important aspect of theater, such that if it's very carelessly done, it can really destroy a scene. If a chime doesn't sound like a chime, but sounds more like a whistle, people are confused. And strangely enough, it's not that easy sometimes. You'd be amazed how sometimes you have to be creative in creating a sound effect so that it really sounds like, I don't know, a boat motor or rain. There are some things that are so common to us, but yet it takes something unique to create them in the sound technology that we're going to use to amplify for the audience. So, any kind of realistic effects like doorbells or thunders or sirens or bombs, clocks, gunshots can be very tricky, very hard to do. So it takes a lot of work to really get your sound effects well. And then also there's reinforcing sounds so that amplifying sounds can be produced for a performer or a musician by things like a shotgun mic. That's highly directional, and you'll see that when you're doing a soap opera, for instance, and there's a shotgun mic overhead or a boom overhead, but it can be aimed at a specific area, so that's the advantage of a shotgun mic. Whereas a body mic is something that you're obviously going to be wearing, going to be attached to the performer. It may be hidden. Now they're just wires. You no longer have to have some kind of a big speaking unit there. And you often see them sometimes attached so that they're continually, consistently in one distance from the performer's voice. But interesting question whether or not it should be amplified in all cases. For instance, we just did Songs for New World in our small theater here, which sits 70 people. I mean, it literally is, nobody is more than 20 feet away from a performer. So why would you need to have mics? Why would they need to be amplified? And they're going to be singing, and you want to hear the voice of the performer. I am very much a believer that the human voice is nice to listen to, but if you amplify it, it can sound a little mechanical. The problem there was we had a band. We had drums, piano, guitar, and the audience couldn't hear the performers over the band, so they had to mic them. So sometimes the decisions of whether to mic performers or not is tough. But in a serious play, it's tough to do. I myself don't feel that it's justified, but obviously for a musical, it's a different story. So yeah, sound can be so critical in terms of what you're doing in a show. If it's a simple sound effect, like just playing a song that the performers dance to. We just had that in the Brenda Project, and I had to change the cue because the sound was at a level that didn't make sense for everybody to jump up and start singing to this Madonna song. We really had to change the level so that it was a real sense of a bump, and that everybody got excited. It made sense that they would then get up on the floor and dance. So it takes some focus. You can't be careless with sound, and a lot of wonderful technologies are there available to directors and designers today in the world of sound. Okay, well, to finish the class off, I want to talk a little bit in terms of a summary and evaluation, and just to look back quickly on what we've covered so far, and I am curious to know if you found any differences between TV, film, and theater. That was one of our first questions. I don't know if you remember that. And also, if you feel that there's something that can improve the class, I would love to hear from it, or what you felt did work, would love to hear from you, or what didn't work for you, because this is something we're always looking to improve the class. So be love to get some of your comments there. You know, we did look back on world theater history. That was one thing about this. We saw how theater can sometimes shift like a pendulum from one kind of form to another. And that was it's kind of unique, like in the Restoration when Nell Gwynn was performing. We looked at an age where performers were always kind of on stage talking about sexual context. Nell Gwynn was a great example of a performer who was known for her sexuality. This was the first time women were allowed on stage. I think we have an image of Nell Gwynn here to show so you can get an idea of what a sensuous woman she was. But the previous age, right before it, was the time where the Puritans actually closed the theater. Now, the Puritans would never allow someone like this on the stage at the time, but this is Nell in the 1660s when theater was, women were allowed to be on the stage and showing more of themselves than the Puritans would ever want. So that's one thing that I hope you got from the history, is how one age would sometimes perhaps go too far and there would be a reaction against the age. And interestingly enough, after Nell Gwynn's time, English theater becomes very Methodist, if you will. By the time we get to the 18th century, everything gets a little more proper and plays that are decadent and about sexuality, no more. So the pendulum of history is kind of interesting to gauge. And also, obviously, how theater is an expression of culture, and that's something that we looked at throughout the history. But you know, the main subject that we've covered is in this class are the elements of production. And that's what we really were hoping to focus on here. So we looked at types of plays and directing and acting and playwriting and design. In fact, we started, remember, looking at the audience. There's a great example, for instance. The audience is something that, I don't know if you remember back to talking about some of the needs that an audience brings to the theater. They need pleasure, they need information, they need escape, they need companionship. In this case, the Astor Place riot in the 1840s in New York City was a need to express their patriotic fervor because they were out there protesting because of this English star, William Charles McCready, had come over to do his performance of Macbeth, I believe it was. And the crowd was very hateful against the English coming in. So they wanted to express their patriotic feelings. So yeah, the audience does bring something with them. That's for sure. We also learned how theater encourages the audience imagination, more so than more visual forms of television and film. We looked at different types of plays. We learned that tragedy compels us to experience what characters go through. And we saw a little bit of, there's a wonderful image of Fiona Shaw from the horrible play, Medea. It was Greek tragedy there. So we learned about tragedy. And in fact, we looked even at Aristotle talking about how tragedy is the fall of a man whose character is good. I mean, Hamlet is a good example. I think I have a good image of Edwin Booth doing Hamlet here. But whose misfortune, there he is, whose misfortune is brought about not by vice or depravity, but some error in his character. And we talked about whether modern tragedy is applicable, is still possible if we don't have kings and queens. And strangely enough, we had one of our midterm questions was whether or not it was possible. And I'm going to quote, this is one of our students, probably shouldn't read an exam essay, but Marcella Boyd did such a nice job on this, I don't think she'll be offended. But Marcella said, "I believe that this quote does apply to Raisin in the Sun." And this was the quote about Arthur Miller saying that tragedy is very possible today, even though we don't have kings and queens. And she goes on to say, "It is true that no one dies in Raisin in the Sun. However, the things they went through made it seem like a modern tragedy. Lena would lay down her life for her family and their well-being. Her daughter would give her life for her freedom. Her son wants to move up in the world, and I could see him trying to justify the things he does to get what he wants. All these are examples that can be traced back to a modern tragedy." So it was an important point that we showed that tragedy isn't just something for Greek classic plays or Shakespeare. We also talked a little bit about comedy. Aristotle did say that there was a catharsis evolved in comedy as well. And we even looked at a lot of the various roles that a director has to perform when they are doing a show. Actually, there's an image from Charlie's Aunt. That's a great laughing comedy, if you will. But we talked about how a director has to be an actor, has to be a playwright, has to be someone who stages the play, someone who's a good designer, who understands design, has to have a good feeling for all of the elements of production, which in a way, studying what a director does is a good way of looking at theater itself. This is a great director. This is Harold Clorman. Clorman helped create the group theater, which only lasted for 10 years, but was very instrumental in what became the careers of Marlon Brando, Ilya Kazan, many who followed. But the group theater was kind of like the Moscow Art Theater of America. They really perfected naturalistic acting, and Lee Strasberg and the Actors Studio came out of the group theater. But Clorman was very strong at looking at directorial concepts. And as you remember, Barry Maxwell came in, one of our students who was actually directing River Niger. He was one of our first guests. And we took an interesting look at what it takes to be a good director, how you have to assume responsibility, take initiative, keep your cool, sometimes be quiet and observant, and being ready to anticipate something going wrong, being punctual, dependable. And we also talked, obviously, about acting in terms of directing as well. Remember Geraldine Gomez, who played the role of Brenda in The Brother Project, came in as one of our guests, and we discussed that whole fascination with whether you should work by the outer technique or by an inner technique. And we talked a lot about the different kinds of training that an actor does. Interesting, I have a comment here by Muriel Hansen on acting from one of our discussion boards. Muriel says, I always thought that being an actor was a very hard thing to do. To become a character that you are unfamiliar with and make others believe what you're saying and to make them feel your emotions is an arduous task. There's a good example. There's Marlon Brando up there. But it is amazing how everyone, talented or not, is acting every day, whether as a social role or a personal role, and understanding the difference between acting on stage and acting in life. Well, thank you, Muriel. That's a very good comment on acting, both on stage and what we do in our everyday life as well. I'm going to get some other student reactions here, too. Let's see what our students have said about... We had one question about the sound, and Emily is saying, I think all performers should have a mic so that their voice can be more audible and crisp. Yeah, well, to some extent, I have a little bit of a hard time with that, Emily, because if it's a small theater, I don't know that you need a mic. But if it's a musical, yeah, it really helps. It does. And Ramzan saying, I think that sound should be amplified even on a non-musical play because the high and low voice represents the emotional level of the scene. Without the amplification, we would lose that. Yeah, to some extent, a big theater like I had for the Brenda Project, maybe some more amplification could have helped. And here's Cassie. I don't think it should be amplified in all cases. In small outdoor amphitheaters, I think it's more natural and more realistic to hear their natural voice. And do remember that the golden age of Broadway musicals in the 1950s, there was no amplification. These were all actors who studied and improved their voices to the point that they... If you have somebody like Julie Andrews up there singing The Sound of Music, you never came out and said, gee, I really couldn't hear you. You had to be louder. Those voices were fabulous. So they did it for many years without amplification. And here's Priscilla. Thanks for coming back, Priscilla. I think it depends on the type of theater. If the audience's seating rows are flat and the theater is large, microphones should be used to project. If the theater is fairly small, there is no need. See, I agree with Priscilla. I think it depends on the specific situation of the size of the theater as well as what exactly is it. Is it a musical or it may be a play like the Brenda Project, which needs to be sensitive, needs to have the warmth of the human voice associated with it. Good. Here's Priscilla responding to our other question where we asked a little bit about an evaluation question. Priscilla saying, I feel that this class ran pretty smoothly. The only thing I would suggest is providing a study guide of some sort so that future students don't take quizzes midterms or finals blindly. Yeah, I know, Priscilla. I'm sorry about that. I just know that if I provided outlines for students, they probably wouldn't watch the broadcast. So that's one of my reasonings for not providing an outline, is to hopefully encourage people to watch the broadcast. But the problem of getting students to watch the actual broadcast is a tough one. I don't know how to solve that. But yeah, maybe we shouldn't disadvantage you, although I think everyone's done pretty well in their midterms, and I can promise you in the final exam, too, that they'll do pretty fine. Emily's saying, I learned the experience is different between film and theater, and that was one of the central themes of the class, is to just hopefully get you an appreciation for just how different they are. Most people just think that it's all the same, I'm sure, but to us as performers or directors, it's a vastly different experience, whether you're behind the lights performing or even watching it in the audience. We know that there's a huge difference. And Cassie is also saying, I gained a greater respect for theater because I first thought film was more realistic. Now I know all the work put into theater, and I appreciate more now thanks to this class. Well, thank you, Cassie. That is really the hope of this class, is to help you appreciate it a little bit more, so that when you go to see film or television or theater, there's a sense that you have a little more insight into what goes into it, and you can appreciate it that much more. Also, you know, one of the things that we did cover in the class was the, in addition to the skills required for actors in terms of how they have to change from a theater piece and then perform for film, it's almost like your voice has to change totally. You wouldn't, for instance, have a body mic on a performer in a film. You want that mic to be a little distance away so that you get a more honest sound. So, but in film, the voice has to change, just as it obviously would change if you're going to perform for 500 people, like in the Brenda Project. So good actors know how to make that transition, and it's not easy. It's not easy. There's a lot less rehearsal in film than there is in theater. Theater, you're rehearsing for 6 weeks. You're doing run-throughs of all of the lines of the play, right, from beginning to end. In film, you may only have a single line on that one day of rehearsal. You may have more on other days, but sometimes, and once you've done that scene and you've said that line or monologue, it's gone. It's not going to come back again. Totally different way of doing performance. I think you can pretty much see that. We also looked at the art of the playwright, of what goes into writing dramatically rather than in the narrative style. And that also provided some interesting insights. If you're a playwright like Garcia Lorca, for instance, you know that conflict is the thing that really draws an audience's attention, and in many of Lorca's plays, like Blood Wedding and The House of Bernarda Alba, conflict was beautifully used. So yeah, Garcia Lorca, one of the famous Spanish playwrights of the 20th century. And he was also aware of the importance of secondary characters and what that contributed to, so that you have a good variety in terms of characterizations. Finally, in the last section of the course, we looked at design, and we looked at the work of scene designers, costume designers, makeup, sound, and lighting today. And a lot of good, interesting insights, too. We looked at stage spaces, how they vary from what has been more traditionally the proscenium format, where audience is all on one side and performers are all on the other side. This is actually the Shakespeare format. This is a drawing of the Swan Theater, which shows a thrust stage. In other words, there's a platform on which the actors stand, and it thrusts out into the audience space, such that the audience is on a three-quarter arrangement. You're actually watching from almost totally encircling the actors. If you were totally encircling them, we'd have then arena, as in theaters like Circle in the Square, where you're actually encircling the performers. But the thrust stage has had quite an influence and has made many proscenium stages kind of thrust out into more intimacy with the audience. And then in looking at costumes, we saw how costumes can be living scenery and how it can give us a real feeling for a kind of intimate world there. It really sets the place and the tone of that character. It conveys occupation or status, period. I have another comment here by one of our students. I enjoyed reading many of the discussion boards and comments in the papers. This is Lindsay Abbott, who wrote on costuming. Costumes are a very important aspect of a play. They allow the audience to tell who the person is and what their personality is like. The book gives the example of a woman in a long white coat. If the audience sees her walking onto the stage, they would assume she is a doctor or a laboratory technician. Costumes really do play a huge part in the production. And I also want to share with you some of the work that students have done on their film reviews. After all, remember, not only did we look at the design aspects of costuming in many cases, there's a great example of it there, and I think that's from a Noel Coward play. But in addition to costuming, we looked at film. We looked at five films, in fact. V for Vendetta, we looked at Crash, The Great Debaters, Frida, and of course Raisin in the Sun. And I had a great comment here that Andrew Turner used in his film review on The Fighter. And this is one of the things that I think was most successful in this class, is to get students to use examples and really focus our work. This is what Andrew said in the film The Fighter. Christian Bale performed the character Dickie to a remarkable level. He developed his character so well. In the way he walked, his swagger showed his hubris. His speech pattern and accent mimicked the real Dickie Eklund nearly perfectly. Not only did Bale change his walk and speech for the role, but he also changed his physical structure. Dickie is very scrawny with long arms in real life, but Christian Bale wasn't before the production. He changed his body to better fit the part. And just quickly, I also have Belinda McCauley, who saw a wonderful production of On the Town at USC and made a comment about how the scenery was quite interesting. As the pieces of the set did not change very much over the course of the play, the same pieces were used throughout the play but changed position in most every scene. One moment, any given piece could be used on the underside of a bridge, and the next was a museum display. I thought this very resourceful method of design. So a lot of your comments and insights on your writings, both for film and stage review, were very unique. Well, I guess we're not going to see you next week, but thank you so much for tuning in and joining us for Theater 100. I hope you have a good time with your final exam next week, and feel free to email me if you have any questions. But thanks again for being a student in Theater 100.